Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much for coming today evening. And I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you. And over the next few days, I'll speak on some life lessons from the Ramayana. I have written a book on wisdom from Ramayana, and I'm writing a series of books on wisdom from the Indian epics, Ramayana, Mahabharata, and other books, Bhagavatam, of course. So today I'll talk about the nature of desire. Now, how sometimes some desires become obstinately strong and how they can be corrected. So suppose we are going along a road, and while going along that road, we see danger ahead, do not proceed. Normally, if we see such a sign, what would we do? What do you think we should do?
Turn around and go back.
Okay, go back or?
Take
some other route. Good point. You know, either we turn, go back, or if we have to go, then we find some other way. But suppose somebody goes on and another sign comes. And again, danger ahead, do not proceed. And still they go ahead. Not one, not two, not three, but there are 10 signs. And all the 10 signs, they neglect and go. They keep going ahead. And then that road comes not to a dead end, but that road just goes to a cliff. And zoom, they just go off the cliff. So now when they go off the cliff, you know, they may forget gravity, but gravity won't forget them. So, if somebody neglects warnings repeatedly, then the consequence, they are responsible for it. So, we know in the Ramayana, who is the villain?
Ravana,
yes. So, what is Ravana's most visible characteristic? Yes, 10 heads, right? Maybe you can let someone raise hands and then answer. You don't mind. So 10 heads. That's why one of his name was Dash Anana. So one of the names in the Valmiki Ramayana, in the Nam Ramayana. The Nam Ramayana is a compilation of about 100 names of Ram, with one pastime being conveyed by one name. So those who cannot recite the whole Ramayana, they just recite the Nam Ramayana every day. And that's how you can remember Lord Ram. So one of the names over there is Samrit Dashanan Ravana Rama. Samrit means to kill. Dashanana, one who has 10 heads. Ravana, that demon, Ram. So can you repeat this name? Samrit Dashanan Ravana Rama. Samrit Dashanan Ravana Rama. Ram Ram Jaya Raja Ram.
Ram Jaya Raja Ram.
Ram Ram Jaya Sita Ram.
Ram Ram Jaya Sita Ram.
So Dashanana, he had 10 heads. Now, there are some people who think there was a branch of science which has now been more or less debunked. It was called phrenology. Anyone good at words? Does anyone know what is phrenology? Phrenology is the idea that the shape of the skull determines the level of the intelligence. So by studying the skull, like somebody is very intelligent, their head must be very big. So they would study the skull, and by that they would try to infer who is more intelligent. Now, of course, the dogma has shifted from the skull to the brain. Now, you know, in Egypt, ancient Egypt, the pharaohs, what would happen to their bodies?
They would be wrapped in bindings, but they never took the brain. They said all the thinking came from the heart.
Yeah, okay. So when they were wrapped, what was it called? Mummy. Yes, thank you. So just as the bodies were mummified over there, now some scientists have taken the brain of Einstein and they have mummified it, hoping that in future, if we find out how to revive a dead person, then we will get Einstein back. So the idea is that some people think that either the size of the brain or the size of the skull, size of the head, determines the level of the intelligence. But that is unfortunately not true. So basically the size of the head is largely determined by the size of the body. A small baby will have a small head. As we grow up, our head will also grow. Of course, some people can have a bigger or a smaller head. But Sir Ravan, he had 10 heads. But he had zero brains. Zero brains means not that his head was empty, but it was not physically empty. But he did not have intelligence. And we'll talk about, today's whole class will be about how Ravan got 10 warnings. So you could say one warning corresponds to one head. So he got 10 warnings, but he neglected all those 10 warnings. And that's how he courted destruction. So now Ravan, at one level, represents the obstinate desires that we have. That we all have desires, and desires are not bad. In fact, desire is what makes us do things in life. Whether it is good or bad, we are all moved by desire. So desire itself is neutral, and it is actually a great power. But if we desire something good, then that brings out good within us. That makes us manifest something good in the world. But if we desire something bad, then that desire can cause bad. So such desire is a self-destructive desire. And different desires have different strengths. Say, if we are passing by a supermarket or a mall and we see, hey, this food item looks nice, let me buy this. Okay, that means it's just a casual desire that has come up. We saw that and we got the desire. But then we see it and then look at the price tag. Hey, not worth it, forget it. So what has happened? The desire came because of the situation. And then another factor of the situation was the price. Forget it, not worth it. So some desires are casual. They come from external and they are also deterred by externals. But some desires are very deep rooted. So now how does a desire become deep rooted? If we consider, last year I was in Calgary. Calgary is in a part of Canada which is quite cold. So I was in winter, so we had gone up a hill for a college program. And we were coming down, at that time, snowballs were forming. Do snowballs form here also? The snowfall here?
Yeah.
Snow, but not snowballs don't form. There's no hill over here nearby. So now, it is interesting, it was quite a winding road up the hill, so we were observing that how at the top of the hill, it is not a snowball. It is just a snow pebble. Tiny. And at that point, if somebody just kicks it, it will just break apart. So, it is a snow pebble and it can be easily cracked. But as it starts coming down, 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 what happens? Yeah?
It becomes bigger.
Bigger. Yeah, it gains mass and gets momentum. So, from the snow pebble, it becomes a snowball. And then from snowball, it becomes a snow boulder. And then by the time it comes down, the same person who could have kicked it away, now can get knocked away. So, that which is so easy to stop, can become unstoppable. So, therefore, the best time to stop the snowball from forming or from damaging is when? Right at the top. The earlier the snowball is stopped, the better it is. So our desires are also like that. Initially when they come, they're just like tiny snow pebbles. But when they roll down our consciousness, that means when we keep thinking about them, when we keep dwelling on them, especially if we keep acting on them, then as we keep acting on them, they start becoming stronger. The illusion often is that when we get a desire, I think I will indulge in this desire, the desire will go away. Yes, it goes away, but afterward it comes back stronger. So, there was a British poet, I think it was Oscar Wilde. He said that giving up smoking is the easiest thing in the world. I have done it over 100 times. So, I gave it up, but it didn't give me up, isn't it? So, I give it up, but it comes back again. So, like that, our desires, the more we indulge in them, the stronger they become. So, when it is a snow pebble, it is easy to break it. But by the time it becomes a snow boulder, it becomes almost impossible to stop. So, for Arjun, for Ravan, his desire had become like a snow boulder. And he got warnings, don't let this grow, don't let this grow. But he was not ready to stop it. And some people say that, I have no determination. Like somebody is maybe alcoholic or somebody may be a drug addict. They say, I have no determination to give this up. But actually that is not true. How that is not true, I'll come to at the end of the session. Everybody has determination to talk about it. But let's go over the Ramayana storyline quickly to look at some of these points. So, we're discussing how Ravan got 10 distinct warnings. It's like the snow pebble is forming and is rolling down, round, down, on. Stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it. But he's not ready to stop it. So, it was Ravan's desire for Sita. That was his destruction. That was the cause of his destruction. And the first warning he got against, don't mess with Ram. Who told him that? Does anyone know? Yeah, Vibhishan was the third character. Yes? Yes, perfect. Maricha, thank you. What is your name? Prahlad, oh excellent. So Prahlad knows about Maricha. Nice. Good. Thank you. So Maricha was a shape-changing demon. Now Ravana could also change shapes, but he had the capacity to change into any shape and great expertise. So Ravana initially, when he heard that Ram had single-handedly destroyed his whole regiment at Janasthan. He was furious. He said, how dare somebody do like this? But then the same soldier, a company, so only one general had escaped from that attack. That his name was a company. Now, a company means, company is what? Doesn't even know? Shaking. So, she trembling. A company means one who never trembles. But this Akampan was doing Kampan. He was trembling when he came to Ravan. And he gave the report and he said, don't mess with him. So, but Ravan said, no, he has attacked me, I have to destroy him. He said, no. Then he said, okay, we'll do one thing. If at all you want to take revenge, don't attack him directly. He said, better you weaken him. See, everybody, now he thought that he is in a, he says, this Ram is a Ayodhya prince, he says, in the jungle. Now he is very attached to his wife. That's why he has brought his wife also with him to a jungle. The jungle is not a very comfortable place to stay. See, everybody pursues things according to their own perspective. Now he did not think that it could be Sita was so committed to Ram that she was ready to be thick and thin with him. He thought that it is Ram is attached to Sita. That's why he has brought her to the forest. So he thought from his own perspective, if he can just take Sita away from him, if he abducts Sita, because he's so attached, he will become weak by that. So then with that plan, he said, that's a good idea. He said, he went to Marich. And when he told Marich, this is the plan, Marich, he became horrified. He said, now, when you have to give advice to someone, or you want to oppose someone, that person is very powerful and superior to you, if you say that, don't do this, who are you to tell me not to do this? So, you have to be very intelligent. So Marij said, Ram is so powerful that twice he has attacked me and the force of his arrow threw me a far, far, far distance away. And now I'm so afraid of him that as soon as I hear the sound R, anything from R, I become fearful. He said, now he's also intelligent. He didn't say, Ram, this is a foolish idea. He says, what enemy of yours has given you this idea? He said, whoever has given you this idea, that person is not your friend. That person is your enemy and that person needs to be punished. So what happens by this? You don't criticize the other person. Don't tell your idea is foolish. Who has given you this idea? That person is foolish. So now, okay, Ravana said, okay. So many times, especially if there are differences in among opinion people and somebody has to be rejected or somebody's opinion has to be rejected, now, it's important to help people save their face. Especially if somebody is in a respectable position, it's important to not make people lose face. So if you give people an opportunity, sometimes, you know, the world is, we have finite resources and we can only choose one path. So if somebody respectable is choosing something and we are saying we cannot accept that, then don't make it a public rejection and humiliation. Because if it becomes a public rejection and humiliation, then it becomes not only their ego comes into the picture. So Maharishi does that. He says, now what enemy of yours is it? Okay. So Ravan conveniently not saying that is my idea. He said, okay, let's forget it. Then he went back. But then after that, his sister came over there. Who was his sister? Shurpanakha. So the word Shurpanakha has many different meanings. So, and one meaning of it is, now there are different ways of doing etymology. Etymology means the origin of words. So, Shurpanakha, Nakha means nails. Shurpanakha means she had nails which were huge. That's one meaning of that word. There are other meanings also, but anyway, now she came and she told Ravan, first she showed her nose had been cut off by Ram. So he has humiliated me. Who was there to humiliate you like this? I will destroy him. And then he said it was Ram and his brother Lakshman. Now immediately, all of Ravan's anger got punctured. He said, yes. The whole story he already knew from Akampan. Akampan had already told him the whole thing. He said, who attacked whom first? She said, actually, I went to them first. They were living peacefully in their territory. You were living peacefully in your territory. It was you who attacked and they defended. So it is you who are at fault, not them. So Ravana is again trying to save his face. Because he, as a citizen, as a king, he has to take action. He says, why should we blame them? It is you to be blamed. Oh, brother, but you didn't know why I went there. Why was that? What happens? Everybody gives their own spin to the story. Sometimes I try to do mediation or conflict resolution. So, usually there are always two sides of a story. And sometimes the two sides are too different and we think, is it two different stories only? Are they talking about the same incident? So, I was just in DC and I was talking with a devotee who is a mediation expert. He said, actually, I learned that for every story, there are not two sides, but three sides. There are multiple sides. So, now Shurpanakha had gone there because she had been first attracted by the smell. She wanted to eat some food. So humans are like her food for her. And then when she saw Ram and he was so attractive, then suddenly her lunchbox changed into her love interest. Completely changed. And then when that happened, when Ram refused, then she tried to kill Sita. And that's when now she had actually caught Sita by the neck and tried to kill her. So some people ask, why did Lakshman have to cut off her nose like that? It was humiliating for her. Actually, you could say he was justified to cut off her neck also. Because she had tried to kill Sita and they had to pull her off. So he gave him, basically, she was let off with a small punishment. But when Shurpanakha went there, now she has her own agenda. So she spun the whole story. Actually, no, my brother, I love you so much. So I feel that you need the best of everything. You deserve the best of everything. And this Ram has a wife, Sita. And she is the most beautiful woman in the whole world. And when I saw her, I felt that she would be the best queen for you. So in order to get her for you, I went there. So she completely changed the story. And then as soon as he started describing the beauty of Sita, Ravan's snow pebbles started rolling. It started rolling. And Ravana immediately, now he was very interested. I want Sita for myself. So now at this time, again he went to Maricha. And when he went to Maricha, what are you surprised? What has happened? He says, I just told him. He says, now earlier he thought that Maricha had given me good advice to protect me. He said, now he thought he's just being disobedient. He said, you know, I want you to assist me. Maricha is about to speak something. And Ravan said, I have not come here for you giving me suggestion. I have come here for my giving you instruction. So if you don't obey me, I will kill you. Then Maricha thought, now I think my life is over. So either I have to die at Ravan's hands or at Ram's hands. So better let me die at Ram's hands. So Maricha had given a warning, but he did not listen. Then he kidnapped Sita. Now along the way also, now there are many people who gave warning. Sita herself warned also. Jatayu also warned. But we'll look at the major warnings. Warnings which were accompanied by some substantial reasoning or some substantial demonstration. So who gave him the second big warning? Sorry?
Kumbhakarna.
That was before Vibhishan. Okay, when was somebody from Mandadari? Yeah, Mandadari kept warning him throughout. I will talk about her warning at the end. That she kept warning him again and again. But somebody came and destroyed Lanka.
Hanuman.
Ah, yes, Hanuman. So when Hanuman came there, Hanuman first, Ravan had thought, I've got Sita now, I'm completely safe. I've got a foolproof plan. Because who can reach across the ocean? Some people think that if doing wrong actions is not the problem. It is just getting caught for doing the wrong actions is the problem. And if I don't get caught, then there is no problem. I saw one cartoon, it said that, you know, a person was caught for speeding. So the traffic cop pulls him over and asks him, did you not see the speed limit? Yes, I saw the speed limit. I just didn't see you. So he thought like that once I get Sita, Lanka is impregnable. But Hanuman came over there, across the ocean, penetrated in Lanka, found Sita, talked with her. He destroyed, where had Ravan kept Sita? Ashokvatika. So it was Ashokvatika, but for Ravan, Hanuman made it to Shokvatika. It's destroyed for him. And then he demonstrated his power. And then even the Brahmastra could not tie him for very long. And then after that, when he tried to, he had Hanuman arrested for some, Hanuman warned him, saying that, if you do not return Sita, you will be destroyed. And further he gave him one more point. He says, you are very proud of Brahma's boons, but remember that you do not have immunity from whom? Humans. Humans and monkeys, we will destroy you. And then, in case he still did not have that assurance, what he did was, Ravan tried to burn his tail. Now, it is not just a funny thing burning the tail. It was his idea was that first he wanted to kill Hanuman. But then he said that, okay, Dutas, messengers cannot be killed. So he says, let us give him a lifelong memento, a painful memento. So just burn his tail so that he will, it will torment him for a long time while it is burning. And after it is burnt, it will be something which everybody can see that he is tailless. And in that way, we will humiliate him, we'll inflict pain on him now and humiliate him lifelong. So then what happened? Hanuman's, there's a tail they said blazing, but from a tail blazing action, Hanuman did a trail blazing action. Trail blazing, you know, he just went around burning everything. And Ravana was so shocked. He just didn't know. And finally, after setting almost half of Lanka on fire, Hanuman stood on the border wall of Lanka. Now, he had to jump across to go back. So, when he stood on the border wall, his tail was behind him, burning. And from there, he told him, he said, I am just one of the monkeys in Sugriva's army. And thousands of monkeys like this will soon come upon Lanka. And stronger than all those monkeys put together are Lakshman and Ram. If you do not return Sita, whole of Lanka will be destroyed. And then Hanuman just pressed down. So normally when you have to jump, you bend down and then you jump, spring up. So when you bend down, the whole border wall that was there, it just crumbled. And it was a fearsome sight to see. It struck terror in the hearts of the Lanka citizens. And Hanuman jumped off. And he ran, he flew back victorious. So this was warning number which?
Two.
Then after that, the third warning was given by Vibhishan. Now when they came, Ram came with the warriors and they were going to cross Lanka. At that time, Vibhishan went and begged with Ram. He said, begged with Ravana. He said, just return Sita. You will save the whole Ravana dynasty. Now, at that time, what happens is that when we decide something, at that time, we have to, at one level, be open to taking inputs from others. So he initially called assembly, and there he said, you know, our Lanka, which we thought was impenetrable, has been penetrated. So what do you think we should do? He asked his assembly, and all the Rakshasas said, actually, this monkey caught us by surprise. But next time, if anybody comes, they will be in for surprise. He says, there's no need to worry. They all started praising each other. Sometimes what happens, people live in what is called as echo chambers. Echo chambers means they only hear those people who echo what they say. They surround themselves by yes people, yes men or yes women. And then they just think, oh, I'm right. So Ravana was surrounded by yes men like that. So that's actually very dangerous. Now, of course, it's not very pleasant to have people around us who disagree with us. But if we drive or silence those who disagree with us, then what happens? We end up surrendering to our own mind. Because our mind gives us one picture of reality, and there might be another picture, but we just get no idea of that alternative picture. That's what happened to Ravana. So Vibhishan begged him. He said that Sita, the desire for Sita will destroy you. And he told him, first he said that, when the other Rakshasa said that, we are just caught by surprise. He said, no. He said, all our defensive arrangements were still as they were normally. Still Hanuman came in. And not only that, we have already seen Ram's power before at Janasthan. So it is best that you return Sita. First, Ravan thought about it. The next morning, so he said, okay, I adjourn this meeting. We'll meet tomorrow. Well, maybe we shouldn't give this meeting. But what happened is, when he went back, all the time Sita was there with him, but he could not touch, he could not unite with Sita because he had a curse and he forcibly violated any woman. He would die. So, night after night, he would sleep with unsated desire. And that whole night of tossing and turning, trying to satisfy his desire and not satisfying it, that destroyed his intelligence. The next morning, Vibhishan went early morning to meet Ravan. And Ravan did not even talk with Vibhishan. And Vibhishan told him, I beg you, please, please return Sita. He said, I'll be humiliated if I return Sita. What I have possessed, I will never return. And then the next day in the court, Vibhishan took out his own crown and he said, you think I'm selfishly motivated? You can reject me, but please don't reject my advice. He took out his crown and put it in front of Ravan's foot. Please don't destroy our dynasty. And Ravan just kicked away the crown. And at that time, the main voice of sanity that was there in his camp, he kicked him away. So Vibhishan not only went away from Ravan, but he went away from Lanka itself. And thus, he sealed his pact with death. So for all of us, there will be people who disagree with us. And now some people, they just habitually disagree with us. Whatever we say, they will say the opposite of that. And such people, there is no need to pay much attention to them. Because their point is not to what is the right way. There are three kinds of vadas or discussions or debates. In Sanskrit, it is said that is, one of them is vitanda. Vitanda means what? That you don't try to prove I am right. Your purpose is only to prove that you are wrong. So whatever you say, I disagree with you. It's like that. So now, if there are people like that, we certainly have to neglect them. But if we know overall that somebody is intelligent, somebody is expert, somebody is our well-wisher, or at least they have acted favorably for us in the past, then to neglect and reject their advice is to surrender to the clutches of vice, surrender to our own mind. So for all of us, this principle that, you know, we actually need social feedback and constructive social feedback to function in life. Say right now, if I make a joke and nobody laughs, I wonder what happened. Or say if I am speaking and everybody starts looking at me as if they are watching a foreign language movie without subtitles. Then I start thinking, what is happening? So it is our feedback keeps us, the feedback that we get from others keeps us on track. Now if we have to alone keep ourselves on track, it is very difficult. Because our mind can come up with so many ideas, this. It like sometimes, some people they work on a browser and look at that, there are 25 tabs open. And there, 25 tabs are open and three of them are frozen and there's a loud music coming and they don't know from which one it is coming. So, our mind is like that. So many voices are coming from there and sometimes we just get stuck on one track. So, it's social feedback that at least rules out the unacceptable options. Now, of course, sometimes social feedback can go wrong also, and that's why we cannot just take anyone's feedback. But the point is that if we don't take any social feedback, then we just get lost inside our own mind. This is what, unfortunately, Ravan did. He rejected the advice of Vibhishan. Then after that, so Vibhishan is Warning number? Three. So I think we are going, we'll have to go a little fast for the remaining warnings. But let's look at this. After this, then when the Vanaras build the bridge and crossed over. Now that itself was astonishing. How do they make a bridge like that? How did they cross over? So then he sent two of his spies, chief spies, to go into the camp of Ram and find out their main warriors, their strategies, their weapons. So these two were, does anyone know their names? Shuka and Sarana. So Shuka and Sarana went in and they disguised themselves. But what happens? It takes one to know one. So Vibhishan was on their side already. Vibhishan already surrendered to Ram. So Vibhishan spotted Shuka and Sarana. And as soon as spotted, these are spies coming dressed, like appearing like monkeys. You are spying? He immediately pointed to the monkeys and the monkeys caught them. And all the monkeys were itching for war. And the war had not yet started. So now they got these two people, they started beating them. So they started beating them. Sometimes what happens is that some people just need to fight. Like in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is described as Jagai and Madai, were two villainous characters. And when they would get angry, they would chase after people. And they would try to find someone to beat up. And all the people would run away. And when they would have no one to beat up, they would beat each other up. They just fight and beat each other up. So anyway, the monkeys were beating up Shuka and Sarana. And that time, Ram heard the commotion and Ram came over there. And he said, what's going on? When he was explained, he just released them. He said, no, you come here. If you have found enough information, it's good. If you want to find, look for whatever information you have. I give you full facility. And you go back to Ravan, tell him that all the anger and the agony that I have felt for months upon months because of your abduction of Sita, I will inflict a crushing defeat on you tomorrow when the war starts. Your only hope is if you return Sita. Now, by this time, Shuka and Charan had seen all the, much of the military formation. They went back terrorized. And they said, there are so many monkeys and such power. And Ram has such power. He said that, actually, Sugriv's power we saw, says he alone is so powerful that he can destroy the best of the demons that we have. And along, so Hanuman is very powerful, Sugriva is powerful, and many other demons are powerful. And Ram and Lakshman are incomparable. He says, please don't fight with them. And now these are his own spies giving him information. One of the words for the spying in English is intelligence. You know, intelligence, if you have our intelligence agencies who go and penetrate. Like this, recently there was this horrible bomb explosion in Sri Lanka in the churches. So the Sri Lankan intelligence was not very active, but the Indian intelligence was active. And the Indian intelligence gave them some warnings, but they didn't pay heed to it. The point is, when we get information from secret sources who are infiltrated into somebody else's camp, then that is, the whole process is called intelligence, because intelligence is based on information. So now it's his own intelligence agency is telling him that don't mess with them. And he told them that, hey, because the monkeys bet you, so you have become scared. I'm not going to be scared. Just dismissed what he said. His own warriors. This was warning number four. Then, that night, Ram sent one more peace messenger. Or an envoy, you could say. Who was that? Angad. Now it's interesting, Angad, when he came there, he just jumped and then came there. And Angad told him that, no, you return Sita, otherwise you'll be destroyed. And you return Sita honorably and we'll go back without any bloodshed. So then he said, why should I listen to you? Then he said, okay, he says, I have such power that I can destroy all of you. Okay. So let's have a test of power. And Anga, he just came in the middle of the assembly and he put his, mounted his foot on the ground. He says, let any of your warriors come and even just move my foot. If they can catch my foot and move my foot, then we will accept defeat and go back. I said, really? So all his warriors came one by one. And they tried to shake and shake and shake. And what happened? They shook, but the foot did not shake. And they got exhausted. And one by one, every single one of them. And finally, Ravan himself got up. And Ravan came towards Angad. And as he came, bent down to catch Angad's foot, Angad just moved back. And he said, if you want to catch anyone's foot, go and catch Ram's foot. This is my challenge, yours for your warriors, not for you. And he said that he actually, as he moved back, he just moved his hand and knocked off Ravana's crown. And Ravana's crown fell down and he picked up the crown and just threw it away. And what had happened was, Vibhishan, when he had come over to Ram's side, Ram had immediately done the coronation of Vibhishan. He said, you will be the next, you will be the king of Lanka. Not you will be the king of Lanka, he said, you are the king of Lanka. You are coronated as the king of Lanka. Now, when Ravan heard this, he was shocked. It's like, say, you are the ruling head and somebody else is already appointed as the head. That means clear that you are going to die. And then finally, he just dismissed. He says, one beggar has appointed another beggar as the king. He just dismissed it. But what happened when Angad knocked the crown like that? The crown went to Ram. He just flew it away. It went to Ram. And then Ram put it on the head of Bhishan. So even before Ravan's death, Ravan's crown left him. So then Angad went back. And he said, you have till tomorrow morning to decide. And again, before going, Angad said, actually, among all the monkeys in our army, I am the youngest. And you cannot move even my foot. What can you fight against all of us? This is a powerful, powerful demonstration. And then that night, several of the elders from Lanka, they came and advised Ravan. He said that. So Malyavan had been the previous king of the demons. And he was like an elder among them. Malyavan said that, oh Ravan, the peace proposal has come from the enemy now. If you accept that proposal, it will be gracious for you. Now you will appear as if doing a favor. There will be no loss of face for you. Just accept it. And he said, why should I accept it? He said, can't you? Haven't you heard the condition that they want me to return Sita? I'm not going to return. The Malyavan told him that actually, you know, desire for a king to desire a woman is not wrong. But a king is not alone. He says, for one woman, if you're going to destroy your whole kingdom, destroy all the citizens, all the warriors, he says, that is it worth it? Says, who says everything is going to be destroyed? He says, I'm going to destroy them. What can a human wandering in the forest do to me? That was the time, first time very forcefully somebody from his own side tells him, this Ram is not an ordinary person. Ram is Vishnu descended to the world in the form that will destroy you. Now, of course, Vibhishan had told this. But Vibhushan, although he was of the same blood, but that mentality was so different that Ravan would take the practical military advice, but he would not take Vibhishan's dharmic advice seriously. He thought this is dharmic advice. So, but when Malyavan said this, he says, Vishnu has come to destroy you. Then Ravan, he said, oh, Vishnu. You know, actually I have defeated all the gods. Vishnu is only remaining. If Vishnu is, Ram is Vishnu, then I'll destroy him and I'll become the conqueror of the whole world. So that is stupidity. To think that somebody can kill God. That is like thinking that they can spit at the sky. What happens if somebody spits at the sky? The spit comes back to them only. So that is a stupid desire. And then after that, another elder came. That was Mayadana. Now Mayadana was the father of Ravan's wife. Who was Ravan's wife? Mandodari. And when Hanuman had destroyed half of Lanka, Mayadana had used his architectural skills. He is the architect of the asuras. Vishwakarma is the architect of the devatas. So Maya is the architect of the Danavas. So he had reconstructed all of Lanka. And he said, he came there. And he offered his Ravan offered his respect because he's older. He said, I'm grateful to you. He says, I have come to ask you for a favor. He says, whatever, ask me. He says, you have rebuilt Lanka and I'm indebted to you for that. He said, I'm begging you, please don't let my daughter become a widow. What do you mean? He said that though if you fight this war, all of Lanka will be destroyed. He said, you think some monkeys can destroy our army? He told him, those are not ordinary monkeys. He said, Sugriv is the son of the sun god. The son of the sun. Then Angad is the grandson of Indra. Neel is the son of Agni. Mainda and Dvivida are the sons of Ashwini Kumaras. Jambavand is the son of Brahma. Hanuman is the son of Vayu and an Amsha of Shiva. So he said, even army far powerful than ours cannot fight against these gods. Against so many of the gods altogether. Hanuman, Ravan, what was his reasoning? He said, oh, the gods, now they are so fearful of me that they are hiding from me in the form of monkeys. But now I will kill them. So he just twisted everything for his own benefit. So this is warning number?
Six.
No, let's go back. First was? Maricha. Second?
Hanuman.
Third? Vishan. Fourth? Shuka and Charana. Yes. Fifth? Sixth? Malyavati. Seventh?
Mayadana.
Yes, thank you. So then, after that, the eighth warning came from Kumbhakarna. Now, Kumbhakarna, he was initially the day when he had this big assembly, at that time Kumbhakarna happened to be awake. Kumbhakarna came for the assembly. And when Ravan asked, what should we do now? So Kumbhakarna said, oh Ravan, why are you asking for our advice now? He said, you should ask for our advice before you abducted Sita. He said, now Ravan felt a little angry, but he didn't want to antagonize Kumbhakarna, he said. And Kumbhakarna said, although you made a big mistake, he said, you are fortunate that you have a brother like me. I will protect you from the consequences of your mistake. Mm-hmm. But then after that, Kumbhakarna had gone to sleep. Now some people, they can sleep through an earthquake. And they go to sleep, it's almost like they go into some kind of tamoguni trance. So Kumbhakarna was like that. When you go to sleep, it go to sleep itself. But somehow after great difficulty, woke him up. And Kumbhakarna was so powerful that even the gods couldn't fight against him. And he went and attacked the Pandava, Ram's army, and they terrorized Ram's, the Vanaras. And it's interesting that when Kumbhakarna came out, normally, when any warrior would come, they would open the Lanka's gates and then they would come out. So then, but Kumbhakarna had to come out. He was so big, they didn't have to open the gate. He just climbed over the wall and came out. Just climbed over the wall. And then just seeing him, all the monkeys fell back in terror. And then Ram came out to here. Ram came, looked in that direction. He saw the terrorized, heard the terrorized. He looked up and his eyes opened wide. And now Vibhishan was next to him. And he said, who is that? And Vibhishan said, that is my brother. That is my brother. So then, but Ram fought with him and he completely overpowered Kumbhakarna. And when Kumbhakarna was killed, his head was knocked off and it went and fell right in one of the walls of Lanka and broke one of the walls of Lanka. His head itself was so big. Now Kumbhakarna had never been defeated before. That itself was another big, big warning. And when Kumbhakarna died, this could have been a very clear signal that warriors who were almost as powerful as him, if they were being overpowered, that means it is very difficult for him to win. Then after that, still he didn't listen. Then he sent his own son. Who was that? Indrajit. And Indrajit, he went and used all his celestial weapons against Lakshman and nothing happened. And then Indrajit, he came back and he told his father, he said that, I use the Pashupat Astra, I use the Brahmastra, none of them could affect Lakshman. He said that the only person who can counter this is Narayan. So he says, not only Ram is Narayan, Lakshman also seems to be Narayan. He says, a double Narayan we have over there. He says, you cannot fight against them. So, sometimes in movie you have double roles. So they were not double, they're not double role in the sense that they're not looking identical, but you have two manifestations. So then he, now when he said, Ravan was so adamant, his own son is coming and telling him, and he said that, Indrajit, if you have become scared of Lakshman's power, then come and stay in the war, or come and stay in the palace, I will go and kill them. Now Indrajit was also a very honorable warrior. He said, oh father, I am not afraid of anyone, I will die. But this war is pointless. I just come to tell you, there's no point in fighting this war. But if that is your desire, I will go. And then he went back. And when he died, that was the time. Now Mandodari, right from the beginning, had been telling Ravan, just the Mandodari is warning number 10. Yes, telling him right from the beginning. Right from the beginning only, when Sita came, he told her, let her go. And but at this particular point, he said that, oh my lord, he says, what? You have started a sacrifice. And in that sacrifice, you are offering the ahuti, the oblations of your own countless relatives, brothers, sons, citizens. And now finally, you have offered our son there. He says, how many offerings more will you put in this fire? I cannot live without my son. Now, if he is dead, you let me also die. And now Ravan was also shocked. He says, you killed our own son. You sent him as a sacrifice. He says, please stop this war. Ravan said that. Ravan also softened when he saw Mandodari's plight and Ravana, Hanuman, and Indrajit's body. He says, please return Sita and end this war. And then Ravan said, he says, if at all I had to return Sita and end this war, says, why did all our warriors die? He says, in the next world, when I meet all those warriors, what face will I show them? If they ask me, that if you are going to return Sita, then why did you send us to death? Now just see the twisted logic. He is not thinking about what face he is going to show to his citizens who are living right now. He is not thinking about how he is going to face the enemy he has to face right now. He is thinking, in the next life, how will I face the people who have died? So what happens? There was an American comedian. He said that, I have already made up my mind. Don't confuse me with the facts. Now, well, how did you make up your mind then, isn't it? It is based on the fact that you are meant to make up the mind. So when he rejected Mandodari's advice, then it was all over. And then finally, in the confrontation with Ravana and Ram, Ram killed Ravana. So for when Ram killed Ravana at that time, or before that, practically all the war generals of Ravana had been killed. So for us, we all have certain things which we want very strongly. And it's not, as I said right in the beginning, desires are not bad. But every desire has to be proportionate. Some people may want wealth, some people may want power, some people may want position, some people may want a particular relationship. There are many things which we want, and it's not wrong to have desires. But desires have to be proportionate. See, all of us, who is the smallest over here right now? 1, 2, 3, maybe all three of them look, 4. Here, you're very small. Now, all of you, you have been smaller before also, isn't it? You're probably fit on your mother's arm, on the hand practically. Or even before, okay, good. And even before that, every one of us was just a tiny cell originally. Now we have millions of cells in our body. It's growth. So growth is natural and desirable. But cancer is also growth. Our cancer is disproportionate and destructive. So when one organ or one part of the body starts growing disproportionately, then that can be, they destroy the whole body. So like that, all of us have desires, but if we let any desire become disproportionate, we let the desire become disproportionate, then it becomes like a cancer. So for Ravan, the desire for Sita was like a cancer. And that cancer, it destroyed his whole body, it destroyed his whole kingdom. So whichever desires we have, we have to think what price is worth paying for this. Yeah, I want this. It'll be wonderful if I get it. But sometimes we just get so obsessed that we lose all proportion. Just become completely oblivious to the costs. Oblivious to what we are paying. So how do we avoid this? This is just, I actually, throughout the class, with the warnings that we got, through that, we discussed that. You know, if we have a good social circle around us, if we use our intelligence, if we understand the nature of desire, that from a snow pebble it will become a boulder eventually. All this is there. But one broad principle is that we cannot reject desires, but we can select desires. That means if I say I have this desire and I don't want to, and I want it, but I know it's not good for me. Then if you just stay battling at that level, it's very painful. But instead of focusing on rejecting a particular desire, we select some other better desire and focus on nourishing that. The saying no to anything is never pleasant. It creates a sense of deprivation. But if we learn to say yes to something better, then that focusing of energy on some healthier desire will enable us to say no without much difficulty. So certainly some difficulty will be there. But it will not be that much. So we have to, more than the whole point of this class is not that there are certain bad desires and we have to give them up. That's true. We need to take our unhealthy desires seriously, that they can have serious consequences. But more important is to have something worthwhile to say yes to and focus on that. And as we focus on saying yes to that, then the no automatically comes. Say, like if this glass, now suppose it were empty and it had air in it. If I want to remove air from it, I need to get a vacuum generating machine and suction machine and pull out all the air. But little misadjustment, little movement, and it will become filled again. Now, if there's another one way to remove the air is to focus on removing the air. Another way is I just focus on filling it with water. If you fill with water, automatically the air will go away. So desires, even the dark desires within us, the destructive or disproportionate desires within us, they cannot be driven out. But they can be crowded out. If we fill our consciousness with healthier desires, with positive desires, with desires for that which is good, then the unhealthy desires will automatically go away. And the process of bhakti yoga enables us to cultivate healthy desires. The desire to chant, the desire to read shastra, desire to associate with devotees, desire to do various services, desire to do even our job and our family responsibility as a service to Krishna. When we have those healthier desires, then the unhealthier desires can be given away, given up. But we also need the reminder that these unhealthy desires need to be given up. And Ravana's story provides us that reminder. So I'll quickly summarize. I spoke on this theme of how Ravana had 10 heads, but zero brains. So I started by talking about how the there was the idea that the person's skull size or head size or brain size determines the intelligence. And that has been more or less proven to be wrong now. But so Ravana had 10 heads, but the 10 head did not mean he had 10 times intelligence. Actually, he had very little intelligence, especially with respect to that destructive desire, his intelligence just didn't work properly. And you talked about how he got 10 warnings. Suppose somebody is going on a road, it's a danger ahead, do not proceed. And they keep just going, then they'll be destroyed. So our desire sometimes push us forcefully in a particular direction. But the desire is originally like a snow pebble. It becomes a snowball, then it becomes a snow boulder. So if you understand how dangerous certain desires can be, then we can stop them when they are snow pebbles itself. And the 10 warnings that Ravana got were from whom all? First, Maricha. Second, Hanuman. Third, Vibhishan. Fourth, Shuka and Charana. Fifth, Angad. Sixth, Malyavan. Seventh, Mayadano. Eighth, Kumbhakarna's death. Ninth, Indrajit. And tenth, Mandodari. Yes, thank you. So through all these warnings, somehow he reinterpreted things to suit his own ideas. So those who opposed him, he just minimized or trivialized or rejected them. And when we live in our own echo chambers, when we reject those who give us good advice, then we can hear only our mind's advice. And that is a destructive advice. So Ravana's eventual destruction, he courted it, because of his rejection of not just the initial mistake, but it was the consistent rejection of advice that could help him to correct that mistake. So we all commit mistakes at times. Of course, Ravana's mistakes was very serious. But we all commit mistakes. But at least when we do course correction, we can minimize the consequence of the mistakes. And the focus in bhakti is not so much on rejecting desires, but by recognizing the serious consequence of certain desires, we redirect the desire. Desires themselves are not bad. They bring activity and motion in our lives. But the desire has to be proportionate. Growth is natural, but cancer is disproportionate and destructive growth. So some desires can become like cancer for us. And to say no to them, we recognize the gravity of their consequence. And then we redirect our energy towards some healthy desires. And bhakti provides us many healthy desires. The unhealthy desires cannot be driven out, but they can be crowded out. As we cultivate the healthier desires for serving Krishna, the lower desires will automatically get crowded out. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Yes, please.
You said Hanuman is incarnation of Shiva, right?
Yeah, Amsha of Shiva.
Amsha of Shiva, sorry. So why did Ravan... See, Ravan is so attached to Shiva, Lord Shiva. So why didn't he realize, this is my Lord who has come and warned me? So doesn't he get that?
Okay, that's a good question.
isn't it that Shiva is so attached to Ravan? So if Hanuman is also Amsha of Shiva, then couldn't he see that it is my own Lord who has come to warn me? As I said that, some people, they are so caught in their own desires that they look at God not as a source of wisdom, but simply as a source of power. See, there is material religion and there is spiritual religion. And of course, in material also there can be sattva, rajas, tamas. But the basic principle of material religion is that, oh God, let's form a relationship. And the terms of the relationship are my intelligence and your power. My intelligence and your power. I want to do certain things. I can't do them right now, but I want to do it. So you do it for me. So such people, they see God more as a tool to an end rather than an advisor. So he did not see, so for him, although he worshipped Shiva, his motive in worshipping Shiva was not to please Shiva and certainly not to get advice from Shiva. He wanted power from Shiva. And once he had got that power, he didn't care for it. So it's why we go to someone also determines what we will take from them and what we will not take from them. And another thing is that unless one has the right vision, one cannot understand that a particular devta or a particular devta has descended in a particular form. Whether it appears to the Lord's incarnations or even the devta's descents. So, when he heard this, he did not take it very seriously. And certainly he saw Hanuman more for his connection with Ram rather than his connection with Shiva. So for him, Shiva was just a source of power whom he would worship and get power from. See, whenever we see someone or see something, we can put them in different mental groups, different conceptual groups. Say, for example, if we are among Americans and then we see another Indian, we see one person is an Indian. Oh, you're an Indian. We put them in the group of Indians. But if you are among Indians, then we put people in the, oh, you're a South Indian, you're a Bengali, you're a Gujarati, you're a Punjabi. So we put people in different groups at different times, isn't it? And say, if we have had a quarrel with somebody who is, say, from a particular religion, or a particular region, or a particular religion, or a particular race, and then if we meet somebody from that background, this person might be very nice, but still, we'll think, oh, you know, people from that group are like that. So we carry our own biases. We don't observe people in isolation. The world is so complex that unless we reduce the world to some conceptual categories, we can't function. Say, if I meet somebody from India, who is from India, I might speak in Hindi. But if I'm going to meet somebody who's American, I'll speak in English. So for functional purposes, this kind of categorization is required also. But when we use this categorization, that categorization at one level can facilitate functioning. At another level, it can block our vision. So because his initial interaction with Hanuman was as a messenger of Ram, so he always saw Hanuman from that functional, that categorization. He is a servant of Ram. He did not think of him as being Shiva. That point did not register within him at all. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Prabhu, we saw that Ravan get so many warnings, but still he proceeded with the killing of his family members and the co-demons of his age. So is it something not being thought of like that, that he actually gave a chance to be killed by all those demons by Lord Ram, so that they can at least get a sign, which, like they can just get free from birth, death, and old age.
Okay.
he did a very intelligent act.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good. It's interesting.
So can we say that Ravan had the intelligence that, okay, all his demons, they all got killed by Ram, so they all got Sayujya Mukti at least. See, there are two different things. One is, there is a thoughtful action which leads to a good result. And there is a thoughtless action which accidentally leads to a good result. Like some people, they are very good archers, or they are good, they use a gun or they use an arrow, and they practice, and they shoot a target and they hit the bullseye. So that is one way of hitting a target. The other is just first shoot and whatever it hits, say that was my target. So the second way, there is no way to miss the target. Because whatever you hit, you will later say that this is the target. So, sometimes some thoughtless actions might also lead to good results. But if that was not our intention, then we won't get credit for doing that action. That way, if we start seeing that, we could say that if A kills B, then probably B had some bad karma because of which B was killed. So, A may say, I'm only giving you your karma. But is A authorized to give that karma? Now there is what is called as vigilante justice. Vigilante means people who take the law in their own hands. Sometimes the state, after due trial, may give capital punishment to someone. But if a citizen takes the law in their own hands, then the citizen becomes culpable. So, even at least in the case of vigilante justice, that person is thinking, oh, this person has done all these wrongs and the state is not able to punish, so I will punish. But in the case of Ravan, it was nothing like that. It was simply his desire. His desire for Sita, that was the whole impetus for the war. So he was not thinking any way of benefiting any of his citizens. In fact, any of his warriors. In fact, you know, Ram, after every night, if the monkeys would be killed, Ram would stay awake late into the night and personally perform all the last rites for those monkeys who had died. On the other hand, Ravan had given a standing instruction that all the Rakshas who die, just pick up their bodies and throw them far into the ocean. Why? He heard that then the next morning when the Vanaras come to fight, they will see that there are no Rakshas who are dead. And they will become demoralized. So he literally did what? Use and throw. You talk about use and throw culture today. So they literally did use and throw. So he had no desire to think of anyone else's wild. Well, he had no, that was not even in his mental radar anywhere in the corner also. Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
Anybody has last one before we adjourn?
Yes, please. Okay. Is it true that Ravan had immense knowledge? Yes, definitely. Ravan has composed for the praise of Lord Shiva called Ravan Stuti. It is not the praise of Ravan, it is praise by Ravan. And even now, if you go to Kashi Vishwanath temple, the Kashi Vishwanath deity is here, on the opposite side, Ravan Stuti is written over there. So he certainly had a lot of learning. And also some people say that he was a Brahmana. And it's not that simple, because these lineages become a little complicated. He came from a Brahmana dynasty. He was Vishrava, the sage Vishrava was his, Vishrava or Pulastya? Pulastya. Actually that whole lineage was there. So he came from a lineage of Brahmanas, but because, just like if say the mother and the father are from two different lineages, then the child can either have prominently the characteristics of the mother's side or the father's side. So although his father was a sage, now he had been seduced by a Rakshasa woman. She wanted a progeny from him. And so then when Ravan was born, he primarily had the Rakshasa characteristics. Because what had happened was, although he had, it was a sage who had fathered him, but it was, the whole thing was not done in proper consciousness. And it was, the so he was basically, he had demonic mentality. So he was from a Rakshasa lineage, but he never, he was from a Brahman lineage as well as a Rakshasa lineage. And he got the characteristics of the Rakshasa lineage primarily. So he certainly had knowledge, but he did not have knowledge about the purpose of knowledge. It is, that is the most important thing. So we can get a lot of knowledge, but if somebody doesn't have the knowledge of the purpose of knowledge, then they can actually become very dangerous. If somebody is ignorant, they can't do much. They can't do much harm also. If somebody has medical knowledge, then they can, you know, they can actually find, know if somebody has medical knowledge but does not have compassion or doesn't have the desire to heal people, then what happens is they can either complicate people's diseases, or they can even steal organs while they're treating somebody. They can even kill someone. They can, in a cold-blooded way, actually, if you see the civilization which caused the greatest deaths, sometimes you think of the First World War, Second World War, or now terrorism, it's a great, big danger. But the maximum deaths happened in the last century in Nazi Germany, then the communist regimes in China. Almost 100 million people were killed in Russia as well as China, which is more than both the world wars combined together. And both these countries were very scientifically advanced. Even Germany was scientifically advanced. So there's knowledge, but there was no virtue. There was no understanding of the purpose of knowledge. So then what happens is that such people can become very dangerous. So Ravan had a lot of knowledge, but there was no understanding of the purpose of knowledge. And because of that, he abused all his knowledge. Okay?
So this is not a question. This is to confirm something. Ravana was basically from North India, right? I heard of something that he conquered Sri Lanka. He went there, captured the whole thing, right?
Okay.
One or two words, I don't want to take
over. Okay, so was...
Something came to mind today.
Yeah, was Ravana from North India? Okay. I was in South India, I was giving a class and Ramayana, and after that one person came to me and says, I am from the RPC. I says, what is RPC? He says, it's the Ravan Protection Committee. I said, what is that? He says, in the Ramayana itself, Ravan died, how are you going to protect him? So he said that actually, what has happened is there have been a lot of vested interests who have tried to reinterpret the whole Ramayana in their own ways. There is a Jain Ramayana. Now, Jains are very nice people in many ways. In fact, culturally, we are quite similar to them and no criticism of them. But there is some person who wrote a Jain Ramayana, some Jain scholar. And what they have done is, throughout the Ramayana, when Ram goes to the forest, he is meeting Jain sadhus. And at the end, when Sita enters into the earth, Ram becomes enlightened and becomes a Jain. So what happens? These traditional epics, they have been reinterpreted by people according to their own vested agendas. So there had been some people who wanted to split India into say southern and northern people. So what has happened? They have tried to reconfigure the Ramayana as an attack by the North Indians and the South Indians. So now what has happened is, so they say that, oh, you know, Ram was Aryan and Ravan was a Dravidian.
Right,
so they tried to reconfigure it like that. Now actually speaking, first of all, if we can look at it in two different ways. One is, let's look at it literally from the Ramayana's perspective. Then we can look at it from a historical perspective. If you want to take it literally from the Ramayana's perspective, Ravan was a Rakshasa. And the Rakshasas are entirely different species. You know, to associate the Rakshasas with Dravidians is an insult to Dravidians. You know, it's a big, big insult to associate the two together. But and it's described that actually Lanka was the kingdom of Kuvera. And he conquered it from him. Now the Rakshasas live at different places, wherever they grab power and they live, get power. So in that sense, to say that he's a South Indian is wrong, because he was from a different species itself. Now if somebody doesn't want to accept the idea that, oh, because some people say that, okay, the Ramayana is true, but all this idea of Rakshasas and Vanaras, this is mythology. So, okay, somebody says, okay, Ravana was there itself. Even if it, for argument's sake, accept that like that, that argument. But still, the point is, there was no geographical consideration in that attack. If you want to configure as a South Indian and North Indians, then the Vanaras, they were South Indians. Kishkindha is definitely not in North India. So, it's not an attack on of North Indians or South Indians. So basically what has happened, that narrative was there, that there's North Indians, South Indians. Now there are different ways to try to counter that narrative. So there is another historian who has tried to problematize within that narrative. This is actually not a conflict between North Indians, South Indians, because Ravana was also North Indian. So what happens, once you start getting into that, that frame of reference, it's very important to put the Ramayana in the right frame of reference. Basically, the Ramayana is not regional. It is not a regional conflict. It is an ethical conflict. And it is primarily, it is ethical lessons that are to be learned, ethical and spiritual lessons that are to be learned from it. So if you keep the focus on that, then that is the best. But sometimes some people try to reinterpret everything in their own ways. So it's best to... Not necessarily we reject those interpretations, but we don't highlight those interpretations. We understand where those interpretations are coming from, and then tell them that is not the way the Ramayana has been historically understood, and that is not the Ramayana that has inspired millions of people. Now, how much do you see Ramayana has, say, caused conflict between North Indians and South Indians? See, it is among South Indians also. There are so many Ramayana commentaries that have been written. There is the Kamba Ramayana, there is Ananda Ramayana, and there is so many commentators, they have written so much about the Ramayana. So, this idea of the South Indian, North Indian conflict, this is primarily a leftist Anglican kind of reinterpretation for breaking India, you could say. So, we don't have to give too much credit to that. Thank you. Thank you very much. Shrila Prabhupada ki, Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki. Thank you. Yeah.